What's up, guys, and welcome back. Episode 6 today. Later on, we're going to go over to Connor Bleackley, former teammate. We were just talking about before we got on here how his accent is so Western Canada and so hockey, but great dude. What'd you think about the Super Bowl, man? We just saw Brady win his millionth ring.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, I think it's so funny because everyone looking at the game, like you would assume the Chiefs would win, and then Brady pulls it out, and you're like, why did I think he wouldn't? You know what I mean?
That's exactly what I did.
Yeah, it was like pretty crazy. I actually bet on the Bucks though. So,
did you? I bet yeah. Chiefs. I took Chiefs in the over and got snuffed.
Yeah, but what's funny is I was like, this is the first Super Bowl I watched like without like the guys, like the team.
Right.
And that was always like a fun night because the coaches were like, everyone was kind of like, yeah, you need to have a Super Bowl party. So it was kind of like you got the green light to do something. So
yeah, it is that. You're right. That probably is like the first time in a long time that I haven't watched a Super Bowl with a team like at a bar or at somebody's house with 20 dudes hanging out. But I always feel like it's the Super Bowl, like Christmas party and Halloween are like the three big things in pro that you do with your team. But no, it's it's crazy. Brady's he's still got it.
It's so funny, man, because. Yeah, like I said, you don't expect them to win, and then they do, and you're like, of course they were going to.
Yeah, before the game, you feel like such an idiot.
Yeah. So no, it's wild. But dude, what about the
dude? If you're listening to us, we're both pointing to our new Stall Story hoodies. They're pre-sale now. We got a week and a couple days, so I think we got 9 or 10 days where you guys can pre-order these. We got some hats up, so be sure to check the link in our Instagram bio to purchase a couple of those and support the pod, support Foxy and I.
Yeah, do it. They actually turned out sweet, dude.
Yeah, they're great hoodies. They got a couple pockets, the high neck. I like them a lot. They're solid. But yeah, enough about the Super Bowl. We get it that Brady's the best ever, brag about it. But last week we talked about how Vancouver was like heating up, and now they have just like completely collapsed. They don't know how to play defense. I think they're 6-9. Yeah. They can't figure it out. Columbus is still kind of in the hunt, but yeah, Vancouver's super fun to watch, but they're almost fun to watch because they just get torched.
Yeah, they played Toronto, right? Matthews is like ripping it up.
Yeah, yes.
He scored like 7 straight games or something like that.
Yeah, that's crazy. Sick goal where he touched it between the guy's stick and then went roof.
I love that little cocky, like, just like that. That's like when you know you're going, like, it's just a quick under the bar, like.
Oh yeah, and he doesn't even like really celebrate. It's like the cocky no Sally.
Yeah. And then Wayne Simmons, he actually just got hurt. I saw
That's brutal. So he was playing so well.
He was rolling. He had a sick goal like right on the goal line. And I love Wayno, you know.
Yeah, I feel like he was in his prime in Philly, so we got to see him at his best.
Now he's just chucking them every chance he gets.
Yeah. Who did he beat the wheels off the other
Ben? Jordy Ben.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Jamie Benn got in a fight yesterday too. I love Jamie Benn.
Yeah. He's on your top 5 power forwards list.
Yes, I think, he's easily top 5.
Yeah. But we're seeing which is kind of scary. But I don't know. We're seeing like kind of some of these COVID shutdowns now, which sucks, man. Yeah. I hope we don't come into a situation where it's like, all right, we kind of got to pull the plug on this thing.
Yeah. I feel like it was inevitable, but yeah, it sucks. Cause like a lot of it is just like, I mean, it's what they have to do, but they're testing the guys so much that like, even if there's a red flag, like it might not even be like a actual positive, it's just a red flag. They kind of have to follow certain things. And
yeah, they keep putting these guys into like COVID protocol.
Yeah.
Which, like, doesn't even mean they have COVID. It means they were, like, around somebody that had COVID.
Or, like,
COVID.
What's the guy's name in Florida? The funny Yandel. He's got the Iron Man streak. Say he, like, has to go on the protocol.
Can you imagine? That would be brutal.
Yeah. I was thinking about that. I'm like, man, imagine having to end because of that.
Like, trash. You're not even sick. You just have to sit out.
You were with someone, yeah.
I mean, would you rather get COVID and have it end or have your coach healthy scratch you?
Yeah.
I mean.
I guess both aren't great, but yeah, no. But I just was thinking about that, how, you know, with this weird time, like something that could happen, it'd be terrible.
Yeah, that's brutal. But the only other thing I wanted to mention was we're not too impressed with Detroit and Ottawa. Obviously, they're kind of going through like this rebuild, but
yeah,
they're pretty clearly struggling. They have some young talent, and they might be good in 2-3 years, but right now they're just kind of struggling.
Yeah, I can't understand Detroit at all. I understand a rebuild, but like, is it like you can't be, you like don't want to be good at all, like at all.
Yeah.
Like I was watching the other night, and I never really watch the Red Wings, but they were playing Tampa, and it was like 3-0 in like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
I was like,
I feel like it's like Larkin, Mantha, and then
Bobby Ryan. Like, yeah. In 2010, yeah, that makes sense.
That's a sick top line.
Yeah. But no, I don't know. I guess that's what they say now. It's like, if you're going to rebuild, you like have to rebuild.
Rebuild, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's interesting. I feel like all the leagues are kind of going in waves. And I know you're not like a huge baseball guy, but we're starting to see like super teams in baseball, like we did with basketball a little while back, like with the Warriors, the Cavs, the Heat. Like the Dodgers just signed Trevor Bauer, and I hate that super team thing. So what I do like about the NHL is that I do think there's like a ton of parity. Like there's like, I think you could point out 8 teams that could win the cup.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree too. I think too, with all these other leagues, is the players have like so much say, kind of, which I'm not saying is wrong, but I think that's one thing that's kind of helped the NHL out is, number one, I don't think guys would really do that. I think there's like more loyalty in the NHL.
It's a different culture for sure.
Yeah. But yeah, I think it's much better how it is with the NHL, where there aren't those, because and then it would just be the super team in Tampa every year.
Yeah.
Or even Vegas. Even though Vegas is kind of
How about they just come out of the gate as like a super team, kind of?
They're just, they're like, here's a bunch of pretty decent guys that we just don't want anymore.
You guys go like fight for a cup right now.
Yeah, here you go.
Do you think Seattle will be that good right out of the gates?
No, I think that everybody's pissed. All the GMs are pissed how it went for Vegas, that it's going to be completely like overhauled. I mean, I know it's going to be, but I don't think it's going to. I mean, at the end of the day, you're betting on guys that really haven't proven themselves yet.
Right.
And Vegas just,
they got lucky with like a couple guys. Like William Karlsson scoring 40 out of the gates. Like,
I mean, then you got Fleury, who's like a free agent at the right time. Like, it's all, I mean, yeah, I'm sure they did their homework and the guys knew what they were getting, but you're pretty much betting on a bunch of guys that either one haven't produced or have yet to like to show anything.
Yeah, like they weren't in a good situation, then they go to Vegas, they're playing power play and they're playing really well. But we just talked about Matthews. So I think there's like 4 teams who got out to really hot starts, and there might be one obvious answer here. So I'll leave Toronto out of this, but they've gotten off to a really good start. So who out of these 3 teams who've gotten off to a good beginning of the season do you think has the best chance to get to the cup? Montreal, Carolina, or Florida?
Man, it's funny because whenever I watch Florida, I really like them, but I don't I just don't think Florida's gonna get to the Cup. Carolina, I would also say that about, but they have been sneaky good in the playoffs.
Sneaky good.
They just have like a, I feel like in the playoffs, you'd need like just a roster of like decent players.
Yeah.
Players. I think that they have a good, like, do a good job of that. And Montreal, I mean, I really like Josh Anderson. I think, and he's been lighting
it. Stud.
And I like the way he plays. But like the whole Corey Perry thing, like what, like those old signings, and then you like kind of same with like Toronto and Spezza, like you kind of, they're kind of like jerking him around, and I'm like, don't sign the guy. Like he, like right. Give him some respect, and like I think that like divides a room a little bit.
Yeah, he's played 1,000 games in the league. Like
yeah, and he's like going on waivers. So, yeah, I'd probably say Carolina if I had to.
Okay.
I think Montreal too.
Yeah, I think Ford is definitely third. They have been really good off the start, but I don't think they'll keep that up.
Yeah.
Carolina is, you're right, they're like sneaky good, and I love Aho. They have some like good fun pieces. And yeah. they had that whole thing where they would do that big celebration after the year. So I feel like people kind of got on their bandwagon a little, but that they are a good team. But I think the thing that separates Montreal's Carey Price and Jake Allen. Like that's a pretty sick 1-2 punch to have in net and to maybe take you
like
through.
I feel like too, you don't even like when we talk about Montreal, you don't even like, for me, I don't even think about Carey Price because he's just like Carey Price. Like goalies, you're like, oh man, he's playing well, or oh, like they need it. He just is like always good. Like it's just like you know what you're gonna get.
Yeah. They've never really, I mean, a couple of years they did, but they never had like a really good team in front of them. And I feel like they're starting to get that. And Jeff Petrie is like the most underrated defenseman in the NHL.
Yeah,
I think he's good.
I didn't realize that till this summer, actually, like watching him in the bubble.
And I agree with you. Josh Anderson is one of the best power forwards or upcoming power forwards that we're seeing in the league. He didn't make the top five, but.
Get him next time.
Yeah. Next year's top five. But the thing we'll kind of finish on, and it's interesting because there's so much more to hockey than on the ice, right? Like, and we found that out through our pro career. And as you kids who are listening, you'll figure out, like, there's more to life than hockey. So what I'm asking you, and I have a couple answers too, but what are some things that you did, like, off the ice during your career that, like, made you feel like, oh, okay, like that makes me feel good. That kind of gets me into a rhythm. Like, what are a couple of those things that you think?
Yeah, I think kind of like just already what you said, like being in a rhythm is the routine. Like if I was in a solid routine, and I mean, in our league, it was so hard to kind of get in that, but kind of doing the same thing every day, whether like, it's not like I was eating like crazy healthy or anything, but if I was eating the same thing in the morning, like before the rink, and I'm like, oh, that made me feel good. Like, and then doing the same things at the rink, like every day, like, and then you start like, I don't want to say that I'm superstitious, but you can start feeling yourself.
But you are a little stitious.
I'm a little stitious, a tad. but I think you can just feel like when you're like, oh, I'm feeling good. And then you're like, oh, it's because I'm doing these things that are obviously, you know, I like to do. And so I think a routine for me was just the biggest thing, whether it was the littlest thing where, you know, I come in and have a coffee and watch TV for like in the locker room for 20 minutes. But like I did that every day. You know what I mean? Like mentally, it just was, you know, that was the biggest thing for me was mental stuff. Like, just feeling like comfortable every day.
Yeah, I was going to say the same exact thing too, because obviously I narrowed it down to off the ice. And for me, like going through the mental grind I went through in college, I almost learned to like not think as much.
Yeah,
I agree. Like, and I think routine kind of has something to do with that. Like me and you would go into the rink every single day. We would have our coffee and we would sit and we would watch NHL Network for 25 minutes and kind of just like almost decompress a little bit and like not think about hockey 24/7, I think is important. And a lot of kids now, especially in the culture that we're in, is like 24/7, like hockey's drilled into their brains, right?
Yeah.
So I think it's important to like go, like for us in our league, like go out with the guys, go bowling, go do something stupid, go do like rookie party is like the best because you forget about the game and you're with the guys.
Super Bowl party even, like
yes, that we were yeah, talking exactly. about. Yeah. But I agree. Like it's the mental stuff. And then I think like the routine, you're right. Like when I would get to the rink, like doing the same stretches, doing a good rollout. And I also don't think of myself as superstitious, but I don't know. The differentiation between superstition and routine is hard to like.
Well, I always like put it like to especially in the ECHL, like, you don't know, like, especially when you're traveling, you don't know what the day is going to be like. You don't know.
Right.
When you're at home, you have different, you have access to different things than when you're on the road, where circling back to what you said about not thinking, not overthinking, like, that was another thing too, that I felt like if I got to a rink and they didn't have, you know, like a bike or something, let's say, and it's like, oh, I like to ride the bike. It's like, okay, they don't have it. Like, I can't, like,
I'll just do a dynamic warm up.
Yeah, I can't, there's nothing I can do about that. Or, and I think that some guys can be like, oh, I need to, like, this is what I do.
That was me in college. Like, if we were on the road and, like, I always had, like, a kick app before the game. Stupid, but I was an absolute head case. And if I was on the road and I couldn't get my hands on kick app, I was like, I'm going to play, like, trash tonight.
Yeah.
Which is so stupid looking back. Like, I was so in my own head that it's insane.
I think in college, like, the schedule's a little different, that you can maybe get away with that a little bit. But, in our league, if you literally, like, had this – like, I always think, too, like, pregame, like, sometimes I'd lay down and I'm like, you know what, like, I don't think I'm going to fall asleep. And it's like, I feel like some guys would be like, I need to take a nap. And like,
there's a lot of guys like that.
Laying there, like, thinking about it, where it's like, oh, I didn't sleep today. Like, I just never let, because there's nothing you can do about it. Like,
and I love having the conversation with guys. They're like, you don't nap? It's like I'm...
I was going to, but it's the 55th game of the year. We're playing Worcester for the 20th time
on a Tuesday,
and I got really into The Walking Dead.
Yeah.
So yeah, I watched a couple more episodes. Yeah,
I watched four episodes of The Walking Dead today. Like, sue me.
Yeah, I still showered. Relax.
Yeah, or we go to Becky's for a solid breakfast.
Oh well. Now that's
a whole nother topic. But we'll move on from our little pre-show chat here into Connor Bleackley. Again, great guy, has a lot of pro experience now, has a really interesting story with the double draft pick kind of situation and how things didn't work out, but now he's kind of, again, like, he's kind of underthinking and kind of just taking it day by day and having fun with it.
Yeah, I think it was sweet. I mean, obviously, we both play with them, and we both know, like, we talk about on the show how his birthday was on Sunday, and he's only 25. And I was like, dude, I didn't even play in the Coast till I was 26.
Yeah.
And he's got 200 some games, AHL, ECHL, and it's unfortunate kind of how it's all worked out when you're drafted like that and everything, but I think he's an awesome, like, awesome guy, awesome teammate, awesome player, and I hope, it can kind of all work out for him, I hope everyone likes it. I mean, he's an awesome guy, funny dude, like, you'll hear the way he talks, and, the Western Leaguers, man. I guess we're a Red Deer pod now, too.
We have so many branches off this podcast.
I love the Rebels. And then all of his 9 teams that he played on too.
Yeah. You guys will see in 20 seconds the mistake that I make. But all right. We'll move on to Connor Bleackley, first round draft pick of the Colorado Avalanche, 5th round draft pick of the St. Louis Blues, and now over 230 games pro. Go buy your hoodies, go buy your hats, snapbacks, meshbacks. That's right.
Two things unite a team: how you play and how you look. Beauty Unis is an American-owned, player-operated company that melds award-winning design with durable, breathable fabric to create award-winning hockey uniforms made with the athlete in mind. Using advanced Tech-Wick fabrics, Beauty Unis reduces jersey weight while maximizing comfort, movement, and breathability. With every stitch, they ensure the performance athletes desire and the quality and creativity they deserve. Beauty Unis, united as one. Visit them online at beautyunis.com.
What's up, guys? Today we welcome another former teammate of Foxy and I's, Connor Bleackley. Bleaks has had an impressive journey playing with the Red Deer Rebels in the WHL and earning not one but two draft selections. We'll get into that in a bit. He was drafted 23rd overall in the 2014 draft and then again in the fifth round by the St. Louis Blues 2 years later. He has now played for 10 teams and is over 230 plus game professional career. He's talking to us today from Allen, Texas, where he's playing for the Allen Americans in the ECHL. Bleaks, thanks for hopping on.
Thanks for having me, boys. I'm glad you started doing this. And I think it's only nine teams, bud, not 10, but
nine. Oh, all right.
Collecting jerseys.
I didn't want to make you seem like any more of a suitcase.
I know.
But, so you're from High River, Alberta. So kind of take us through, you played the WHL. So kind of take us through your time in youth hockey and then the WHL draft and your time with Red Deer.
Yeah, man. Pretty typical Canadian kid. Grew up with a rink in my backyard and started there playing against my older brothers and stuff. Being from a small town, you play in your hometown until about Adam. And then once you get to double A level, we started traveling and bringing in the surrounding communities. And then when I got drafted to Red Deer, I think it was the only option for me. Didn't really think about school too much. I kind of wish I did, but it worked out real well. Tell me I could be on a video game at 15. So went to Red Deer for 4 years. It's a great junior city. And then pros kind of taking me on a wild ride, playing with nine different teams.
Yeah, Bleaks. Well, the pride of High River, Alberta. I think that's one of our like top cities, top listening cities. Actually,
yeah.
Started the show. High River. It's just the internet out there. You know how it is. But yeah. So I guess you're our first Western leaguer. I think our first major junior guy, maybe.
Maybe.
How does that work? Like, how does that whole draft like? Because you get drafted at a younger age than like the other leagues, the other major junior leagues, right? So like, how does that whole process work?
Yeah, man. You get drafted at, I guess, your second year Bantam. So 1 year before you can actually play in the league. I remember the draft day. I don't even know if my parents had Wi-Fi at the time. So I went to a buddy's house, watched it on the internet. And then you go to your camp the year before you can play. And then as a 15-year-old, you're allowed to play five games in the league while your midget season's going. And then after your midget season's over, you can go join the team. And that's what I ended up doing. I played five games with the cage on. And then when we lost out in playoffs in midget, I went up there for the rest of the year and played 16 games.
So, I mean, I feel like it's kind of rare. I mean, for us, we play college. You typically go there for 4 years or whatever. But in junior, I feel like guys sometimes bounce around. You stuck with Red Deer for your whole time. What was that like, and what does like that city mean to you?
Yeah, well, I mean, in Red Deer we were gearing up. So we hosted Mem Cup my 19-year-old year, and we had a really good team. Red Deer was awesome. It was good because my parents could come to every home game. It's only 2 hours from High River, so Red Deer's your typical junior hockey town. There's about 100,000 people in Red Deer, and really cold winters, awesome rink, everything at the rink. I guess I didn't realize it until I went to pro, but I don't think I've had a nicer dressing room and a nicer setup than we had in Red Deer. So from that standpoint, it was awesome. And it was cool to go to a different school in high school with your hockey buddies and then travel back and forth when you go back home for the summer and you go back to your school in High River. So that part was pretty cool.
I'm a huge Western League guy. You know that. I think, yeah. And if I was to play anywhere out there, I think I think me and you both know I'd be a rebel. Love red beer.
it's in your blood.
It is. I've grown up a Rebels fan. You know how it is. Now, so you're playing, obviously, and as you're where were you drafted in? What round were you drafted in the WHL? Did you just tell me that? First rounder, no biggie. So yeah, you kind of
brag about it.
So you're playing. Like, when did you start realizing, like, oh, I could get drafted to like the NHL? Like, was that even a thought, or was that kind of like, well, obviously it's a thought, but when did you kind of realize that, you know, you could play professionally and get drafted?
I think going into the draft year, I remember my goal was to be a top 100 pick. I didn't really know what was going to happen, but I had a really good start to the season in my draft year. And then I was thinking first round. And then, you know, looking back on it, it was a crazy year with, you know, you're talking to teams all the time. I was a captain in Red Deer. You know, you're meeting with teams after games. And then after the season's over, it's a bit of a whirlwind. You go to the combine, and I played U18 for Canada after the season. So I think I went home for like a week. Then you go to Toronto for like a week at camp there. And then we went to Finland for U18. So I was there for about 4 weeks, come home, probably 2 weeks, and then the combine, and then two more weeks, and then the draft, and then straight to development camp after that. So that was a bit of a crazy year. But obviously I was fortunate enough to get drafted by my favorite player of all time and my favorite team of all time. So that's something that, you know, it was kind of like a storybook. It didn't quite work out the way I'd hoped, but I'll remember that for the rest of my life for sure.
How are your combine numbers?
Not bad, man. I think I came second in the Wingate.
Really?
Yeah, man. I'm more of a power guy. Not much.
Cocky told me the same thing, dude. I feel like you guys are all just in on this second.
Dude, it was hard, man. It was in like a hotel conference room, like on the carpet, and you're just kind of like a piece of cattle, man. They just shuttled you through. They go, you take your tarp off to do your measurements and stuff, and then you put it back on. And then we got to the vertical jump, and they're like, oh, yeah, take your shirt off. That's us. Yeah, I'm still taking my tarp off. You're grown, man.
The old hotel conference room jersey off.
Yeah.
But like that's time. Wild. You say how you're drafted by like your favorite player, and it didn't work out for whatever reason. But like, how did it work to where you went first round to Colorado? And then 2 years later, you're part of the St. Louis organization. Like, what was that feeling like? Because that's super rare in the hockey world.
Yeah, it was pretty tough time for me. I, honestly, when I was 19 in Red Deer, I had a tough start to the season. I was hoping to play in World Juniors and all that stuff. And then I broke my leg in January, or I broke my kneecap in January. I hadn't had the best start, and then I got traded. So I got traded. I was going to, I was going on the radio in Red Deer. I was live on the radio talking about the Rebels, and this is on the trade deadline day. And the radio guy looks at me and goes, I just got word that you got traded to the Arizona Coyotes. I was like, what? And then like my phone's blowing up, and I'm like, okay. So I step away, and then sure enough, they're like, yeah, we traded to the Yotes. And so I talked to Coyotes GM at the time, John Chaika. And so I was looking forward to coming back for playoffs and having a good, strong playoffs and hoping that they would sign me. And then last game of the regular season, I landed on a skate, cut my wrist. So that kept me out of playoffs. And then so how it works is when you're a first rounder and the team doesn't sign you, they get a second rounder as compensation. So that's what Arizona ended up doing. And then I've got two pretty drastically different draft day stories. The first one, it was, you know, in front of, you know, on TSN and stuff, and millions of people watching. And then my second one, it was in my sweatpants at home.
Oh man, well, hey, they're both better than either of my draft days, buddy. So
you've been drafted as many times as Foxy has A games.
Yeah,
what's that?
You've been drafted as many times as Foxy has A games.
Dude, yeah, thanks.
You guys both climbed the ladder.
Gotta climb it, man.
Yeah, yeah. Dude, just stay hungry. You know me.
Yeah.
It's my work ethic.
Yeah, it is your work ethic.
And that's how you got
your double XL t-shirts.
That's all I can afford. So yeah, you obviously then end up with St. Louis. Where did you go right out of junior? Then did you go was it Chicago? Is that who they were with?
Yeah. I guess I wasn't signed, and then I got drafted, and you know, obviously all I wanted was an NHL contract. I remember just training my ass off, and then about 2 days after the draft, my agent calls me, and they're like, yeah, they want to sign you. And so that took about 15 minutes, and I was pretty pumped with that. And then went to development camp right away, and then got home at the start of Stampede, and finally had some money in my pocket. So I had a good time there. And then they wanted me to go to St. Louis to train. So I went there for a few, probably in August, to train with Dunner and the boys. And then we went, got sent down to Chicago. And I guess that's where, you know, I really learned that the AHL's the real deal. I think our opening night roster, every single guy but me played in the NHL. So they always got a good team in Chicago.
Yeah, that's crazy. But like, when you look back now, like, you've played 230 pro games. Like, you've been on 9 different teams, not 10. But like, playing pro is so much fun. And I think that you love, like, kind of just like the grind. Like, you like being in the locker room, like, kind of shooting the breeze with the guys, going to have some drinks with the guys, hanging out. So what's like your favorite story, like maybe off ice or on ice, that you've had from your pro career?
That's a good question, man. I was thinking of one for you guys that's pretty funny. my first game in the Coast, I really didn't know what to expect from the Coast. I played the whole year in Chicago, and then got sent down to Kansas City, and I think they had, you know, a bunch of different guys on the roster that year. But anyways, so we're playing, and we're winning. We're up 5-2, and all of a sudden the fans are just start chanting something, and I'm going, I look over at the guy, I say, what are they chanting? And they're chanting, "We want burgers." So we scored 6 goals. They got free burgers. And sure enough, while they're chanting, we went down the ice and scored. And, man, the place erupted. So it was
hopefully the burgers weren't made by Roby.
Carabas, man, for if they had 10 icings or more. That's why they had to get rid of Tolkien and Carabas.
Man, I actually had like the first time we obviously traded for you in like January, and so my first like memory of you is pretty funny too. Where we were in the middle of the 8-10, remember, Wally? You met us, I think, in Brampton, but you couldn't play, like you had a concussion.
Yeah,
and I remember just thinking, I'm like, what the, like, this guy came here and we have nobody that could play and he can't even play. I'm like, what is going on?
And yeah, that was bad on my part, man. No, I went home for a week and I was like a new team and blah, blah, blah. And Riley's like, yeah, I kind of want you to meet the guys and stuff. And I come one day before the All-Star break. And I remember, man, I got to my room at the Red Bank. And all it was a mattress, no sheet, no pillows, no, like, no blankets. And it was like 6 in the morning. And I was just like, what am I doing?
So I remember that Brampton game, because that's the night before I blocked that shot. So me and Bleaks were up top sitting in the lounge having popcorn, watching the game.
Popcorn. Man, that might be the least fans I've seen at a
ever
game in my life.
Yeah.
There was not 100 people there.
There was less people than the like minor league game before.
Yeah.
Minor hockey game.
We did Wally got hurt, and I remember the night before I didn't play because I had scrambled eggs going on up there too. But Wally got hurt, so I had to play, and I'm like, so wait, we got this guy finally gets in and like we can't even use him. I'm like, there's 7 people at the game. I'm like, what the – Wally's – and you guys are smashing popcorn. I'm forechecking the beast.
We had, like, a waitress up there feeding us popcorn.
Yeah, we actually did, man. That was pretty elite, but that bus ride after wasn't.
So yeah, what's
Well, well, I remember too, kind of like that's when we obviously got to know you as a bus ride home. The boys had a couple drinks, and I'm like, all right, he can stick around. We'll leave him.
Western League guy, bud. You should have known.
Oh my god, yeah, always dialed.
Yeah, you never sleep on a Western League guy. What no. What's going on now? Like, obviously, it's a different year. Where obviously we planned on you being in Maine with the Mariners, and then all this coronavirus, COVID stuff happens. So, kind of talk us through what it was like, obviously not playing with the Mariners, and then ending up with the Allen Americans.
Yeah, man, it was weird. As you guys know, I was hoping to come to Maine, and then we kind of got blindsided by that shutdown. But I guess it wasn't too. It was as to be expected, kind of. And then I just kind of waited around. And that first day that we got told we weren't going to play, I talked to the Allen head coach. And it was kind of a spot in the back of my mind. You guys probably haven't played Allen before, but it's a lot better to be on Allen than play against him. Because I think my first 30 games in the league, I played Allen like 15 times. And they always seem to be good. And I like that Texas weather. So stayed around for Christmas because that was important to me, and then signed with Allen and headed here January 2nd. So I guess I've been here for just over a month now.
What I know we were talking before you headed down. What number did you end up going with there?
I didn't get to pick, man. I don't know when I'm gonna get to pick, and I've had like 8 different numbers in pro. I should probably get one that sticks, but this is my second time wearing 10, so. I'd like to be 9. I was 9 in junior, but 10's not bad either.
What also, do you remember the last game that you played before the shutdown?
Yeah, dude. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming. I'm just doing my job as a winger, you know, trying to get the puck out and a little shoulder check for the D-man and then right in the jibs. So knocked this jib out and the worst part was I kept getting the puck back, right? My skating around with the puck. And then after the game, I missed like the whole second period because they're freezing it up. And he puts the freezing right in the nerve. It's probably the worst pain.
Oh,
it was a bad omen, man. I was going to get my teeth cleaned for the first time in like 4 years. I had signed up for that. And then I went to the dentist to get my tooth pulled. It was the most pain I think I've had. It was worse than my wisdom teeth, man. And so I had a chipped tooth and missing one for all of quarantine and a bad haircut.
Yeah, I remember those lifts you were doing.
What's that?
Those lifts you were doing upstairs and that when you were sending the Snapchats to the boys were incredible.
Yeah, I was trying
the
to
haircut didn't matter.
Raise a bit.
How much better did your shot get during quarantine too?
You know, it was probably the least amount I skated in my whole career, which was kind of nice. I actually started firing everything up, kind of had a semi plan, a good plan, get ready for the season. And then everything got shut down. So I didn't have my gear on for 6 weeks before I even got to Allen, just outdoor rink. I went over to a buddy's house and scraped off the pond by his house and we flooded that thing and made our own rink, so that's where I was skating.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, when everything was going on, you're one of the guys I talked to quite a bit. So, I was surprised to kind of see, you weren't signed anywhere. I know we were talking, but how's it? How different does it feel to be out west, like playing out there? I know that you've touched on it before, but it's obviously like a different style than playing out east with Maine, no?
Yeah, I mean, it's more what I'm used to. The east was what was a lot different to me. I remember like one of my first games, somebody got rocked, and I'm like, oh, here comes a fight, and there was no fight. Because if that happens, over here, and there's a fight always, and there's always scrums, and there's, getting to the front of the net's a little bit tougher, quite a few more chops and stuff. But I think that just the league as a whole is a lot different this year. It's way better than the last few years, obviously, with less teams and lots of teams go with four lines too. So the pace is pretty good, but It's been fun, man. I mean, we went on a 6-game win streak. Didn't have the best weekend last weekend, but I think we're right there as far as best team in the league. So it's always a lot more fun when you're winning, and you guys know that for sure.
It is crazy how different the West is from the East. So I had the pleasure of playing out in Rapid City, South Dakota. And I remember, like, I mean, you guys know how I play. Like, I'm not like a tough guy.
Soft.
But that year, I fought 6 times. And last year I maybe fought once or twice, but it's so different. You're right. Like, every time there's something like a push or a shove in front of the net, like, somebody's probably dropping the gloves.
Yeah, it is, man. We almost had a tilt in warmups last year against Allen when I was with Idaho, but I think there's probably less and less of that every year, but
yeah,
it's still definitely there because those guys are useful. And it seems if one team has one, then, you know, the rest of them kind of have a guy who can stir it up a bit.
Right. We'll take a couple seconds here to recognize our guys over at Bissell Brothers. I'm drinking a Swish right now, which I think is my favorite beer from Bissell, but they have awesome beer. So if you're ever in Maine, any Maine listeners listening, go over and get yourself some Bissell Brothers, grab some merch on BisselBrothers.com.
So Bleaks, what, I guess, I mean, you might have to cut this, Wally, but,
no, don't cut it. Like Biz on Chicklets.
So what's the, obviously this year is different a little bit, but like going forward, what, I guess, like how much longer you think you want to play, like, you know, you think the AHL is still an option? Like what do you see yourself here, like hockey wise in the next couple of years?
It's a good question, man. I think about it often, but it's hard. I mean, you can't get too far ahead of yourself. I learned that pretty early. As soon as you try to plan or have something in your head, things have a way of not going your way. So I think I'll probably head over to Europe eventually. Last year was what I thought was my chance to stick in the A and prove I was a top six player. And so getting sent down from Texas when I had played my best hockey, that was real tough. And then obviously with getting called up to Hartford for one game, and you kind of feel like it's just they're just tossing you a game. But hopefully just have a good year. I'm not looking too far ahead of this year. I really want to win. I think we have a team here that could win a championship. And then I think when you win and you're on as part of a team that wins, everything kind of takes care of itself. But I'll definitely play in Europe before my career's over. And as far as how many years left, I don't know, man. Maybe I'll make her to 30, but we'll see.
Yeah, I will. Wally, before you went on, we were talking about how he's only 25. I'm like,
I know, man, it's crazy.
That's the old veteran. But no, man, I like obviously asked, like, us playing with you, like hearing your story and everything, you know, it never works out how you want it to, but I think you're, you know, an awesome player. So like, I mean, we've all been in those spots. Obviously Wally's been up. I got called up too, but like, yeah, never, it it doesn't work out always how you want it, but I think you're a hell of a player. So it's like, I'd love to see you kind of get that opportunity again. And, you know, obviously you're one of my buddies too. So I say you keep rolling, man. You're only 25.
Yeah, I was talking to my dad, and he's like, "Who you got on the show this week?" And I was like, "Connor Bleackley." He's like, "I don't really remember him that much from Maine, because like it was towards the end of the year, my parents were going down to Florida." But I was like, "Yeah, like honestly, like he was drafted by Colorado and then St. Louis, and he's been like coast and A guy, but I genuinely feel like he's young enough and good enough where he could like end up playing in the show. Like, I feel like you could grind it out for a little bit and like really make that jump, because I, like Foxy said, I think you're a great player, but
Thanks, boys, you're pumping my tires here.
Yeah.
Hey,
that's what it's all about.
And now that you're not playing with me, you might, actually.
Yeah, we only got like one or three shifts together and we got a goal. I don't know what Riles is doing.
But before we finish it off here, something that we introduced 2 episodes ago is quick hits. So we'll We'll ask you 6 or 7 questions and you kind of just rattle off an answer for us. Sound
all
good?
Right.
All right.
Yeah.
Favorite road city and pro?
Jeez. Well, I'll just go with Idaho. When I was in Tulsa, I was blown away by the downtown of Boise. So that was
a good one. Boise is super underrated. For
San
sure.
Diego. San Diego's tough to beat too.
Favorite sport other than hockey?
Golf.
Okay. One lesson you would teach a kid now coming up the ranks?
Just have fun. I think too many times there's kids that are forced to play or their parents kind of want it better than they do. But, you know, hockey teaches you so many things, more than just the game, and just for have as much fun as you can for as long as you can.
Best guy you've ever played with?
Oof. I guess my first year pro, I played with Kenny Agostino. He had 83 points in the American Leagues. He was he made it look pretty easy out there.
I played with him growing up. He got so nasty when he got to Yale. He was
good, man. He's so good. He'd go through the legs on the power play, sauce.
Cross ice.
Like if it didn't work the first time, like he'd still do it again.
Yeah, Foxy. He's a Del Barton boy.
Oh, nice. Yeah, not my neck of the woods.
Favorite player growing up?
Joe Sakic.
All right. Is a hot dog a sandwich?
No.
No? Okay.
No.
What? who's winning the Grey Cup this year?
The Eskimos. The
Grey Cup, dude? Man, we got to get you out to a Saskatchewan Rough Riders game. I think that's the most fun you can have, man. I haven't been to one in Saskatchewan yet, but I'm going to go next whenever they start up. But bigger balls, bigger field.
We're a huge CFL podcast.
Stronger drinks.
Yeah, dude. It's eight teams, so the odds are good every year. And I think Saskatchewan sells like half the revenue for the whole league, man. I think they might sell more merchandise than some NFL teams.
All right, and last one. What's the best spot in Western Canada during the summer?
Well, I live in Calgary in the summers. It's pretty damn good. I imagine Vancouver's pretty good. I have a funny story about Saskatchewan for you guys. There's a golf tournament at where my grandma's from, and I got some buddies, like told them the weekend, everything, we're going to go up to this par 3 tournament. And then a week before they postponed it till the next weekend because there was a concert in Regina 2.5 hours away. Like Garth Brooks was in Regina. So like, the whole province just like shuts down like 5 hours away. Our golf tournament can wait till next weekend.
That's incredible.
Garth is in town, boys.
Yeah. Oh, if there's a Riders game, it's game over. Like my cousin's taking a party bus from Moose Jaw. Like,
oh, right on.
That's awesome. But no, thanks for hopping on. This was awesome. It's always fun to talk to former teammates, especially guys that both Foxy and I played with. But best of luck in Allen, man, and hope to see you soon.
Thanks for having me on, boys. I'm glad you started up something like this. I think the minor leagues there's minor league madness that started up too. I think guys from the minors definitely have some interesting stories, and keep up the good work, and send a hoodie my way.
Yeah.